Welcome everyone, we're ready to start. Last week we discussed this thing here, AES in various modes, CBC or CTR. What was the goal of this symmetric cryptographic system? What function is it providing? Introduce randomness in the text, that's true, but that's what it is doing, not what is its goal. Why is it doing that? It's replacing a plain text by a ciphertext, which is appears to be random if you don't know the key, that is true. But what do we want to achieve when we use something like this? Confidentiality, exactly. We want that it is impossible to read the plain text by receiving just the ciphertext if we don't know the key. So we want to hide the plain text. That's one function that we discussed abundantly last week, and that uses a symmetric cryptography. Symmetric means that the key is the same for encrypting and decrypting. Symmetric cryptography is used for another form of security function that is called confidentiality, or more precisely integrity, and the key word here is message authentication code. Message authentication code is illustrated by this diagram. The goal is to make sure that the data cannot be modified by a man in the middle. This is exactly what you're doing in the second lab, for those of you who take the advanced lab. A man in the middle can take some data and modify it. For example, if I am sending an order to my bank to pay some amount of money to buy a subscription of something, if you can change the account number to which I am paying the amount, of course, I believe I will be sending something, but the man in the middle will modify it, and the bank will receive something that is not what I sent. The same thing can happen in any system, but in the context of smart grid, any measurement should, in principle, find a solution against this. If an attacker can gain access to the communication lines of an electric utility and can modify the measurements that are being sent, for example, then the control system will be fooled and take wrong decisions. That's what we're doing in the lab. It applies to everything, not just measurements, but also control action. If I'm sending a control action to a device, but if somebody in the middle can change some of the bits of this control action, of course we can create chaos. The function here is called integrity or authenticity. Integrity means that the message was not modified on the fly, and authenticity means that we are sure who is the root source of the message. This is provided by a function called message authentication code that works as follows. Like symmetric encryption, it has one single key that is used for at the sender and at the receiver side. You have a message that you want to send, and you want to bring this integrity function at the sender before you append to the message what is called a tag, T here, which is computed by combining the message and a secret key. At the other end, when you receive the message, and the tag, and you verify it by using the secret key. And if the tag that you recompute is the same as the one that you have received from the message, then you declare that the message is authentic. Otherwise, you declare that it's not authentic. It's a bit similar also to what you do when you receive, for example, some software. You download some software and install it. Typically, if you use sophisticated software for that, you should verify that the software is correctly authenticated. But we will see that for software, we use a slightly more complicated things than a simple Mac as shown here. How does a Mac work? It's a bit like cryptography. In fact, we'll see it uses the same primitives. It uses number theory, in some form, including elliptic curves. Here is a simple, it may use number theory. Here's a simple Mac invented by Homer. As you know, Homer usually invents bogus things, so this one might have a few problems, but it will illustrate exactly some of the problems. We interpret the message as an integer. For example, if we write a message as a string of bits, then we can interpret the string of bit like a binary, the representation of a binary integer. So it's a very long integer with many, many digits. And then we do some arithmetic function. Like here I have A and B. Red are the secret keys. So A is the multiplier and B the offset. I multiply the message by A. I add B modulo P. P is a prime number, that is one of the constants of this scheme, so it's public and well-known. But A and B are the key. For example, if A is 58, B is 180. I take here a toy example of a small prime number, 257. In practice, if you use such a scheme, you would take huge prime numbers that are written on several thousands of bits. But for the purpose of illustration, I take a small one here. And if I have to verify, to create a tag for the string hello, I code it in some form. Here I took a very basic encoding scheme where I translated the ASCII representation of those characters here, which gives 4845, etc. C4, C4 are the character L. And then I do this multiplication. I interpret this as a very long, very large integer. I multiply this very large integer by 58, I add 180, and I took the remainder modulo 257, obtain 35, for example. And this is my tag that I will transmit. You could use this, for example, to do a wire transfer to your bank. So assume you have to pay Penelope for money for a little work she did for you. So you do a transfer to the destination bank account, and you have all the fields that you find in a money transfer, usually, including a message to the recipient. Then you tag, you compute, you translate, you consider all of this. You first translate it into a string of zeros and ones, and you apply this operation. You obtain F7. If somebody is intercepting this message when I send it to my bank and modifies the bank account number, for example, to put the attacker's bank account number, then, of course, the tag here will be different here. So if I receive, if I am the attacker and I don't know the secret key, then I'm unable to create this new tag here, so I'll do a random thing, which with a very large probability will not be equal to the correct value, 74. Is this a secure Mac? This Mac that... we see that the vast majority of you says C, it's insecure, which asks the question, what is a secure Mac? Well, the question is sort of giving the answer, what is a secure Mac? Here, we say that the Mac is insecure if we can easily compute the key, which would be a problem, and is indeed the case. If I see, in this case, only two messages, if I see M1, T1, M2, T2, then in order to compute, and if I know this scheme is used, which in general is the case when we use cryptographic system, be it for confidentiality or for Mac or other systems, the usual assumption is that the system is known. So we know the algorithm, but we don't know the key. Here we can compute it because computing A and B means solving a system of two equations that is linear in A and B. Now it's not linear in the usual sense, it's linear in the sense of number theory. But in the case if P is a prime number, everything here is exactly the same as if we would have standard real number computation. So we can solve the system of two equations by whatever method you have to solve a system of two linear equations. So if M1 is different than M2, which means if you have seen two tags corresponding to two different messages, you can compute the key, and then of course this is not a good Mac. So what is a good Mac? A good Mac is certainly one that should make it impossible to find the key. But more precisely, as we have, as I have written here, a secure Mac is one that makes it impossible to create a valid tag, even if you don't know the key, by observing a large number of messages. Right, so obviously Homer doesn't satisfy this thing. There are many Macs that have been proposed, and it's exactly like for encryption. Many of them have been found to have problems. It's very difficult to make something that is certainly unforgeable. It's easy to do something that is unforgeable for easy attackers, but sooner or later there might be specific types of messages that cause problems. We'll see an example with cryptography in a minute. One of the very frequently used is Mac. Is built based on the same building block as we saw last week, called AES. AES is a block crypto system that is able to encrypt a block of 128 bits. Then we can use the same for creating a Mac as follows. First, you take the length of the message that you want to encode and the secret key, and you obtain the first block, and then you chain like we do in CBC Mac, but here it is different. The goal is not to create an encryption of the message, but it's to produce just one tag. So you chain the output of the first block, which is only based on the length of the message, and you XOR this output with the first block of 128 bits of your message, with the same key, of course, which gives you a second block. And you do that until you've exhausted the message. Of course, you need to pad your message such that it is an integer number of 128 bits. And at the end, you obtain a tag. Right? If you want to verify the tag, you have to do exactly the same operation. It seems fairly obvious, but is not entirely obvious, that if AES as a building block is secure, then this is also secure. What is less obvious is that it is important to give the length of the message here, somewhere in the sequence of blocks that you encode. And it has been proven that if AES cannot be broken, then this system is secure in the sense that it is not possible to forge a message that has a desired tag without you knowing the key. So that's one of the things we use, for example, in the lab, and probably is used in many of the systems that we use online, as we'll talk a bit more later. Right? So in practice, if you put a tag to such a message, you will obtain 128 bits like this one, and not a few bits or bytes like I showed a minute ago. Now, the tag provides integrity in the sense that if I receive the message and the tag, when I recompute the tag having the secret key, for example, I am the PDC receiving PMU measurements, the PDC is equipped with a secret key. When the PDC received this message, or when the bank received this message, if the bank software and my reader software have created a session key, then we can tag this, and if the tag is correct, then it is extremely likely that the message has not been modified by a man in the middle. However, this, of course, was designed to provide integrity. Can it provide confidentiality at the same time? Can I use this to make the message confidential? What do you think? What would it mean to make the message confidential? Well, it would mean to not send the message in the clear, but send only the tag. Is it possible for a well-equipped receiver to recreate the message from the tag? Well, if you can, you will win the Turing Award. Or even the Fields Medal, because of the pigeon hole principle, there are only 128 bits in this string. So with 128 bit, you cannot do a one-to-one mapping for messages that are more than 128 bits. So if we would use that for encryption, that would mean we are encrypting only messages that are extremely small. So a tag is a small amount of data, and it is not meant and cannot be used for confidentiality, for encryption. We could ask the reverse question: if I do encryption, could I use that for verifying authenticity? If I send you a message, I encrypt it with my secret key. If you receive it and you decrypt it with the secret key and you see a message that makes sense, then probably you could think only me or only somebody who has the secret key could encrypt it, right? Sort of makes sense. So it seems that we should be able to use encryption for authenticity. But this is true only if you have an encryption mechanism that has been tested for integrity. Remember, when we criticized the encryption system I showed last week, we said, well, we criticized it because it's possible to infer some data from the ciphertext. It was Caesar's cipher. Well, we can guess the data. So when we criticize, when we verify, when we attack as scientific community, when we attack a cipher or an encryption system, we test it for confidentiality. So most encryption systems, or good encryption systems, have been tested and certified for confidentiality, which means that if they have not been tested for authenticity, for integrity, there might be a problem. There might still be a subtle way to make it leak somewhere. So there are systems. So the most recent systems, there are combined crypto systems that are designed with the intention of providing both authentic integrity and confidentiality. But most confidentiality systems have not been tested for that. Therefore, in many cases, you want to provide both encryption and confidentiality. If I take the PMU to PDC measurement system, we certainly want to provide integrity. We want to make sure that a man in the middle cannot tamper with the data, because it's a very easy way to attack our system. Probably we also want to provide confidentiality. Why would you, as an electric grid utility operator, why would you see any value in hiding things like electrical measurements or even commands that are being used to systems? Is that an overkill, or would you find it meaningful to do it? What do you think?
Overkill?
It's an overkill, so it's academic paranoia in some sense. Well, think about the Ukraine grid attack. What did the attackers do? They infected the computer of that is inside the smart grid by stealing the password of one of us. And since the people who run this grid think it's an overkill to do any kind of confidentiality, but also integrity, they could learn everything. They could see all the commands that are on the line. And by seeing all the commands, they could learn and understand how to forge attacks. So since you don't really know what attack will be, if you know exactly all the possible attacks that will come, then you buy all the software that saves you against them. But you don't know what the attack will be, so it is safe, if you care about not being attacked, it is safe to hide what you're doing. By hiding what you're doing, you make the attacker's job much more difficult. So in some sense, you're right, it's an overkill, because the only fact of seeing the data will not give immediate leverage to an attacker to do something bad, but a sophisticated attacker will gain intelligence about your device, about your system, your grid, by reading the data. So you want to keep them as confidential as possible. In some other settings, there might be also customer privacy issues. Typically, the utility data very often are considered private. They don't want that the public gains information about it. For example, because if you know exactly the power consumption of industrial plant, of an espresso machinery, for example, that's building coffee capsules, you can infer something about the company. You can know that things are going bad or good because they use more electricity, for example, or they work more at night than they pretend they do, etc. So you typically want to do both encryption and integrity function. So a classical way to do it would be to, if you have a message, like a PMU measurement data, you encrypt it and you send it encrypted. Then you also add a tag using a MAC with a different key, hopefully, and then you transmit both here. That's the classical way. But if we use this classical way, because some of the confidentiality system have not been designed with the idea of being combined with authentication, there might be problems. Here's an example, a famous example that was revealed by our colleague Serge Vodnay of Epfl. If we use AES-CBC, which is one of the standards that's considered to be secure, but if we use it with what is called a chosen ciphertext attack, chosen ciphertext means I am, as an attacker, I assume I have a system that is allowing me to send, to receive, and therefore will receive, ciphertext that I'm sending to. So I send to you a ciphertext, you will decrypt it, and you could say, well, nobody can do that because if I can if it's a wrong ciphertext, I will not be able to decrypt it and I will see it's an attack text. However, in computer science, there are always little nasty details. One of them is the so-called error messages. So typically, if you send a message to a system, to a website, for example, if something unexpected happens, you expect the website to respond with a correct error message so that you know why it didn't work. Instead of trying to connect somewhere, nothing happens. You don't know whether you did not connect because the internet is down, Google is down, DNS is down, or your certificate is out of date, like happened during the weekend, for example, for the DTLS certificate of the lab. Right? We'll talk about certificates a bit later. So typically, it's considered good practice to send error message. AES-CBC uses error message when the padding is incorrect. Remember, AES-CBC is based on a primitive that encodes blocks of 128 bits. So if you have a message that is not exactly a multiple of 128 bits, you need to add bytes to make it a multiple of 128 bits. But then you need somehow to signal how those bytes, that those bytes are not part of the original message. That's called the padding. And what AES-CBC does is verify that the padding is done in a correct way. If you pad in a way that's incorrect, that means the message has been corrupted somewhere, and the AES-CBC will send an error message. The padding oracle attack consists in assuming that you have a system that can receive as many encrypted messages as you want, and then you forge messages that are padded with subtle mistakes. You can read in the literature what those subtle mistakes are. That would take perhaps 2 hours to explain that in detail, so we won't do it. But if you can do that by sending one after the other incrementally encoded subtle mistakes, then you can leak some information about the key. And having gained some information about the key, you can complete with a brute force attack at the end to find what is the key by having to search for a much smaller set of messages. So that's an example of a confidentiality system, of an encryption system that is vulnerable to what is called chosen ciphertext attacks. Of course, in practice, to make such an attack, you have to be sure that you can send to the system a very large number of bogus ciphertexts and that the system will not complain, which illustrates one of the things of security. Security is not about implementing is not only about implementing a crypto system like ABS, AES, CBC. You need to implement this system, plus you need to implement a correct management system that will observe error messages and flag situations that don't seem normal. For example, if your PDC starts issuing error messages at a very large rate, that means in the best case that you have a bug somewhere, and in the worst case that your system is under attack. For example, somebody is trying to get the key by doing a padding oracle attack. Now, one of the observations is that if you use this combination, the padding oracle attack is possible, because if I try to send a large number of messages of fabricated ciphertext, of course they are not authenticated, they've been fabricated by me. I don't have the secret key, I'm the attacker. I send a text where I just did the padding subtly wrong. But of course the tag that I'm sending is completely wrong. But if those two things are done independently, then I will still get an error message from the crypto system. And similarly, if I first compute the tag using a MAC function, then encrypt the whole thing, I can manipulate the encrypted text and I will receive those error messages. So at least for this kind of crypto systems, secure combination consists in first encrypting, then computed the tag, and then before decrypting, you will first verify the tag. So if I do this, an attacker must be able to forge a very large number of tags that will be considered valid by the system. Now to know that, you need to know that if you have a secure MAC, you need to know the secret key of the MAC. In other words, if I do this combination, I make it impossible for the attacker to submit to my system a very large number of forged ciphertexts. Therefore, this attack will not be possible. That's an illustration of the combination of encryption and MACs that typically today must be done in this way. Or if we do it in one of the other ways, we need to make sure we limit the number of ciphertexts that are submitted to a system. I mentioned also that the state of the art, which is this today, is also being improved by what is called authenticated encryption with authenticated data. So the most modern crypto systems, symmetric key crypto systems, try to do both with the same system. So a single encryption scheme that will provide confidentiality and also a proof that the system is of integrity. So MAC is used typically online, like the system we saw last week. Symmetric cryptography is very fast. There are very fast implementations. So if we do, for example, encryption of real-time systems, that is typically what we will use. I skip this, we'll see it a bit later. Now I jump to perhaps the most interesting part of cryptography, which is asymmetric cryptography. In summary, what we have seen so far is that if we are able to correctly distribute a secret key to the two ends of a communication, we can make sure that the message is unreadable to an attacker and cannot be forged by an attacker. Confidentiality and integrity. But this poses a number of problems. For example, how to generate and distribute the secret keys. If I have an industrial grid with one PDC that gets readings from 2,000 PMUs, I need 2,000 secret keys that are stored in the PDC and in the PMUs. And since confidentiality is like milk or yogurts, it gets stale after some time, you will need to change the keys once in a while. So you have a key distribution problem. And one of the questions is how to generate and distribute the secret keys. Another problem is how am I able to generate and distribute secret keys when the relation between A and B is not a strong trust relationship. For example, between me and my bank, although I trust my bank most of the time, the bank perhaps doesn't really trust me, but certainly my computer is not trusted by the bank. When I use my computer or my smartphone to do an e-banking transaction, those two computers have no, the bank computer and my computer have no reason to trust each other. I don't have a good reason to trust the bank computer because over the internet I'm never 100% sure that what I see as a web page of my bank is in reality being sent to me by my bank and not by another computer that pretends to be my bank. So how do we solve this problem, the problem of trust? This is solved today using a technology called asymmetric cryptography. Asymmetric cryptography, a synonym is public key cryptography, as opposed to secret key cryptography that we saw a minute ago, has been used to solve this and other problems. And like symmetric crypto systems, it can be used to provide encryption and authentication. In the context of public key cryptography, encryption is called public key encryption, and authentication is based on what is called signature or digital signatures. So public key encryption is very similar to symmetric key encryption, except now the keys are different. There is one key for encrypting and one key for decrypting. And the magic is that the key for encrypting doesn't need to be secret. So what we call a public key crypto system is a system where I have a plain text, so same terminology. I want to send it and I want to prevent that anybody who is wiretyping can read the text, so I want to keep it secret. So before sending it, I will encrypt it with the public key of the receiver. And then to decrypt it, I need the private key of the receiver. And the assumption, the security property, is that if you don't know the private key, reading the ciphertext does not give you any information. It appears to be a random text to you, like for private key. So this is exactly the same properties we had with the cryptographic crypto system, except we have this apparent paradox. I mean, how can I make something here completely unusable when it's been encrypted by something that's not secret, that's public? That's one of the paradoxes that was solved the first time by Rives, Chamier and Edelman in 1977. So it was really the breakthrough, and this is what makes the internet usable. Of course, there are many things that make the internet usable: TCP congestion collapse, HTTP, Google, but also certainly public key cryptography, without which the internet would be even more insecure than it is today. I'm describing here RSA. RSA is still being used today, although it tends to be replaced by a variant or a slightly different system called DSA, elliptic curve DSA, but that will give us an idea. So here is, as usual, I use very small numbers to make the thing explainable on a whiteboard. It's based on number theory, where I use a large number, which is a prime number. So this is not very large for cryptography, but it's large enough for my board here. And then this is known, this is public, it's a constant of the system. Then the secret consists in having the factorization of a large number k. So k is a large number which is made public and it's an integer, and it has the property that it factors out into exactly two distinct prime numbers. Any integer can be factored into a number of prime numbers. That follows immediately from the property of prime numbers. The prime numbers are those that you cannot break into factors. So if you break a number into factors until you cannot, automatically at the end, the things you cannot break or you cannot factor are prime numbers. It is believed that factoring is a difficult problem, at least as long as we don't have quantum computers. If we give you a number that is 2,000 or 3,000 bits long, and I ask you find the prime number, so it will take a time that is astronomical, even if you use all the computers that exist on Earth today. So it will take you a very large amount of time that is well beyond the time we have for any reasonable attacker. So we go the other way around. We take two prime numbers, P and Q, that are large, order of 1,000 or several thousand bits. We multiply them together, which is a fast operation, and we reveal the result of this multiplication. And it is believed that when you receive this string of several thousands of bits, computing the P and Q is an astronomically difficult problem. So your private key is the factorization, and the public key is the result here. So the key idea behind public key cryptography is that there are one-way functions. There are operations that are easy to do in one direction, but practically impossible to do in the reverse direction. One of them is this, the multiplication of two prime numbers. Now, how does it work? If I have a text to encrypt, so first I map the text to a sequence of integers modulo the public key here, like we did in AES, but now the public key is much larger, so I also use padding if necessary. And what the encrypted text, the cipher text, is equal to the plain text to the power e, is this number here, modulo k. And it turns out that this is not a very complex operation. Exponentiation might take a lot of time, but takes polynomial time in the number of digits of the exponent. And in particular, if you take an exponent that is a power of 2, if you want something if you want to compute something to the power 8, for example, a simple algorithm consists in I compute the square of x, I obtain x squared. Then if I square again, I will obtain x to the power 4. If I square it again, I will obtain x to the power 8, etc. So if I want to obtain something to the power 2 to the power 16, all I need is to square it 16 times. So computing the square is the basic operation. You do that 16 times, and then it's plus 1, so you will multiply by the number itself. So this prime number has been chosen such that it is a power of 2 plus a small number. So this is a relatively easy thing to do. The decryption is a bit more tricky. So the decryption, of course, so the encryption, as we can verify, requires you to know the capital K here, the modulus, and the exponent. The exponent is a constant. Capital K is the public key. For the decryption, I need to know the secret number, P and Q, and then there is a little number theoretic theorem called the Chinese remainder theorem that says that if you compute the product P minus 1, Q minus 1, or the least common multiple of P minus 1, Q minus 1, you call that little k, that's the first thing to do. So this is static. Once I have obtained P and Q, I can compute little k once for all. Then the magic is here, I compute little f, which is the multiplicative inverse of e modulo k. So what is that? That means f is an integer, such that f multiplied by e is equal to 1 modulo little k here. So of course this looks a bit magic, but the thing to know is that computing this is relatively easy. There is a polynomial time algorithm called Bezout algorithm that has the same complexity as doing a division by hand. If I give you a very large number to divide, for example, you have 2,374 objects to divide into 7,558 soldiers. This is what the Romans did when they had a treasury to divide, to give to the different soldiers. So they had to do the division, and I'm not sure how they did it with Roman digits, but there is an algorithm to do this division by hand. So it's very similar to what we do here. So we will obtain very easily f, and then there is this property that if I take c to the power f, c is m to the power e, then c to the power f is therefore m to the power ef, and since ef is equal to 1 plus a multiple of little k, by the Chinese remainder theorem. The Chinese remainder theorem says that m to the power k is equal to 1 modulo large k. therefore this will give M. We will not go into the details of how that works. You can look many references to find out. But let's see an example. Here I took E equals 7 to make the example simpler. The public key is 3 times 11, so 3 and 11 are prime numbers, and I reveal 33. Of course, this is a joke, this is a toy example. If I give you 33, you can decompose 33 into 3 times 11, and you have found the secret key, the private key. So this is, of course, not a very illuminating example, but imagine that the number is very large and finding 311 is not possible. Now, what is k? K is the least common multiple of p minus 1, which is 2, and 10, which is not, oh, sorry, it's not the least. Here I took the product. It works with the product as well, but the operation is faster if we take the least. So let's remove the least. We take a multiple of p minus 1 and q minus 1. That gives us 20. The decryption exponent is therefore the inverse of 20, is the inverse of E, which is 7, modulo 20. So 3, 7 times 3 is equal to 21, modulo 20 is equal to 1. Modulo considers only the remainder in the integer division. So 7 and 3 are inverse pairs, modulo 20. If I had taken 10, I would have the same. 7 times 3 is 21, which is also 1 modulo 10. So, but the operation here would have been simple. So the key thing we want, in fact, the true private key, is the F, is the decryption exponent. So anybody can know E equals 7. Anybody can know 33. But in order to compute this 3 here, we need to do this decomposition. And then we have the property that m to the power 7 to the power 3 is equal to m, which we can see here. If I have a number, a message to encode, here I encoded it not using ASCII because I wanted to be modulo 33, so I encoded simply the capital letters from A to Z using numbers 1 to 26. Here is the message. The ciphertext is equal to this. Here, index 33 means I treat it as a number modulo 33. 33 because of that, to the power 7, that gives me the sequence 29, 27, 20, 10, 27, 21, 06. And then this is the ciphertext that they will receive. If I want to decrypt it, I simply need to take this to the power 20, to the power 3. So if you compute the cube of this, modulo 23, modulo 33, you will find 2, which is exactly the same here. So you will decrypt exactly the same text. So this is how RSA, at least our toy RSA, works. And with a few modifications, this is how the true RSA, that is widely used on the internet, works also. I say with a few modifications, there are a few weird things. Like here you see, for example, the 10 is equal to 10. So 10 to the power 7 is equal to 10. So that might be embarrassing if you have lots of texts that are encrypted, that are equal to their encryptions, you might leak some information. So you want to avoid those texts. So the theory of RSA says that there is only a very small numbers of objects that have, of symbols that can be coded in this way, and we avoid them. So you need to be a bit smarter. And typically we also use a nonce, like we've seen with AES, because it's a block cipher in some sense. So we also use a random number that we add here before doing this. And if you put all of this together, you obtain RSA. So RSA is used to provide confidentiality. And if you would like to break it, then you need to guess the private key, which is possible if the key is not too large. So if you would use a key of a few hundred bits, there are now brute force attacks using clusters of computers that would be able to find it in a few hours or tens of hours. So you need to have very large key sizes, which starts to be a problem because everything becomes big and the computations also take time. So a first message here is that all of this is not as fast as symmetric cryptography, not as fast as AES. So when you compute this, you compute RSA to find the encrypted message of a message here. With RSA, it will take on a computer like we have on our tables today, it will take several tens of milliseconds to compute one, to encrypt one message, which is okay to do some online transactions, might not be okay if you want to do, for example, PMU streaming measurements. There are other methods which are based on slightly different systems but have the same properties of RSA, and the state of the art today, if you want to be fast, is called elliptic curve cryptography, which continues to take tens of milliseconds, but which you can pre-compute some things to make it a few milliseconds only, and primarily has also the interest of having much smaller keys, which reduces many of the problems. Encryption with public key cryptography is not typically used to encrypt a whole stream of data, but instead, it is typically used to derive the secret key of a symmetric crypto system using what is called hybrid encryption. Hybrid encryption is typically done when you use your web browser to go to your bank, for example, here. When you go to the bank, then you will learn what the computer of the bank will give you their public key and has their own secret key. And then what you do is your browser will simply compute a session key, which is obtained by drawing a random number, L. Then what you send to the bank is the encrypted session key using the public key of the bank. So Y here. Now the bank will receive this because the bank knows the private key. It will decrypt and obtain little L. And then the little L is the L we will use to you with, for example, with CBC AES to encrypt the rest of the transaction. And you can do similar things if you have to authenticate the transaction with a Mac. You can create a secret key for the Mac here. So what did we achieve here? We achieved that the secret key, L, that is known to the two ends, is the same on both ends, but was never sent in clear text. So an attacker that reads this will read the public key, which is public, so it's not learning anything. And then you will learn why. But what is why? Why is an encryption using the public key? But if the public key crypto system is secure, we know that it is impossible to get L from simply reading Y. And similarly, once we have Z, we have an encrypted system encrypted with L, but since L is not known, this does not give us any information on the messages here. So we have achieved the possibility of having a shared secret between two systems without ever sending it in the clear, which is a major use of hybrid, of a public crypto system that solves the key distribution system. If this is the bank and the browser, or if this is the PMU and the PDC, we can install those secret keys here by having only one thing, having to give the public key of the bank to all the PMUs here. Voilà, we'll do a break. Thing did not ring, but it's time to do a break, and we will resume at 10:15.